Hi, welcome to ICA Online Service. I'm Bebe, I'm ICA Worship and Volunteer Pastor. Before we start the service, here are some important announcements that you need to know.
We have children's church material available for your kids, so you can download it at bit.ly/ICAKidsOnline. We hope you and your child can have a great experience and encounter God together. Follow ICA Kids on Instagram to get the latest updates from ICA Kids. ICA Prayer Service is going stronger on Zoom every Tuesday at 6:30 to 7:30 p.m. You can check our Instagram on Tuesday and get the meeting ID and let us be strengthened by praying together. Friends, we provide a new way for you to donate online to the ministry at ICA. You can scan the QR code on this screen or just visit icsby.com/giving for more information. Have you followed ICA on social media and subscribed to ICA channel? We've prepared devotion recipes and more interesting content and updates to accompany you during the quarantine, because physical distancing is not spiritual distancing. ICA annual business meeting will be happening on Sunday, October 25th at 6:30 p.m. on Zoom. It is going to be the first online business meeting in ICA. This meeting is only for ICA members. So, ICA member, you will receive an email to be able to join this meeting. Until then, please save the date first, because we hope all of the ICA members can join this important meeting.
ICA, keep focus. We are starting a new Bible reading plan to keep you focused until the end of the year. You can just go to the link on our slide or simply scan the QR code to get started. And follow us on social media to get more information.
Those are the announcements for this Sunday. Now it's time to worship God. But before that, don't forget, stay healthy, wash your hands, and wear your mask. Happy Sunday! Worship God together. So let's do this. From wherever you are, let's worship God together with all your heart. Come on.
I count on one thing. The same God never fails. Will not fail me now. You won't fail me now. In the waiting, the same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. When my heart is heavy all my days, yes, I will. We count on Him, I count on one thing. The same God who never fails will not fail me. Won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late, working all things out. You're working all things out. Oh. mind that the highest King would welcome me. I was lost, but He brought me through His love for me. His love for me. Who the Son sets free, oh, it's free. I'm a child of God, yes I am. Free at last, He has ransomed me, His grace runs through. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me.
Forsaken, I am.
brokenness and pain is all I know. Oh, I won't be shaken. I won't be shaken. My faith doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love.
Yes, God.
Oh. Shame no longer has a place to hide. I am not a captive to afraid to leave my past behind. Oh, I won't be shaken. No, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand.
We don't need to fear because we are able to experience your love in our lives. Lord, I just pray for those that are experiencing fear and feelings of fear about the future or what right now holds and the circumstances that they're facing, that God, all of those fears would disappear and fade away in the reality of your love, the assurance of your care, and your power to intervene on our behalf. Lord, I just pray specifically right now for single adults that are living on their own right now, and perhaps because of social distancing, they're by themselves and feel a level of isolation and loneliness. Lord, I pray specifically for those that are feeling isolated and lonely, that God, you would be close to them this week. Lord, that they would experience companionship and intimacy, Lord, both with you and with others this week. Would you make that happen? Lord, I pray you'd bring healing to those that need healing, provision for those that need provision, wisdom for those that are dealing with problems and need to make decisions. God, we just give ourselves to you this morning. We entrust ourselves into your love. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Well, good morning, ICA. I hope that you've enjoyed our sermon series that focused on the life of Jesus. This week is actually the final episode of our series, The Chosen. Next week, we begin a new series entitled The League of Kings, and we're going to study some of the life lessons of some famous kings in the Old Testament. This week, we're going to follow some of the plots in episode 8. And there's a number of plots that you could follow, but we're going to focus on just a couple. The first scene begins in 2000 BC during the Middle Bronze Age. And the scene opens with a group of men digging a well in a field, a place that would later be called Bir Yaakov, which means the well of Jacob. And of course, the men digging are Jacob and his sons. And then the scene skips ahead in time to the first century, but it's the same well. I want you to watch with me together as we watch this scene from The Chosen, episode 8. At Jacob's well, we find a solitary woman drawing water. You can see that she has lived a difficult life. She's alone, and she's unseen. As we follow her to her house, we meet her husband sitting at a fire in their home. Their marriage is falling apart, and she asks for a divorce from her husband, and her husband refuses. The next scene transitions to a dinner party being hosted by Matthew, the tax collector, a newly recruited student of Jesus. And when the religious leaders see what's going on, that Jesus is associating with such morally compromised people, they question Jesus' authority as a holy man. And Jesus reminds the religious leaders that it is the sick who actually need a doctor, not the healthy. Again, the video transitions to Nicodemus, the religious leader looking for the truth. Nicodemus is investigating this preacher from Nazareth, while his wife wants to return to their life and family in Jerusalem. As Nicodemus and his wife are thinking about and reflecting on their life in Jerusalem, Nicodemus recalls the inscription above his grandmother's room. It said, Adonai El Rohi, meaning my God who sees me. One of the themes in episode 8 is the idea that God sees us. El Rohi, God who sees me, my God who sees me. I think all of us at some point ask this question, is God there? Does God even see me? The answer to the questions from the video and from the scripture is this, that God does see you. He is Adonai El Rohi, my God who sees me. Every single person breathing on the planet is seen and loved by God, both your friends and your enemies. Those who are righteous and those who have lived messed up lives. None of us are invisible to God, regardless of our circumstances, our past, our failures, or our sins. The truth of Scripture is this, God sees you. Now, pay attention to your Bible, because the video series does not always follow the scriptures entirely. When it comes to the dialogue or the chronology of the events of scripture in the Bible, it doesn't always match with what we see on the screen. It's one of the reasons why we read through 3 of the 4 Gospels in the month of September, so that you will be able to know the difference between the scriptures and the artistic license that the producers of the video series used to create a TV script. But this episode also follows Simon and his wife Eve. Now, Simon was traveling around with Jesus and was involved in his ministry. But in the meantime, Simon's wife, Eve, is back home taking care of the house, taking care of the business, and their sick mother back home. The film shows how that this weighed on Simon's mind and was a burden to his family back home. And while the dialogue between Jesus and Simon's wife is not recorded in the Bible, we have to conclude that Jesus knew Simon's wife and had had a conversation with her at some point. Jesus explains in the video to Eve that God sees her, and that the role that she played in supporting her husband and caring for her family was important. In the film, Jesus says to Simon's wife, "I see you." And ladies, perhaps you're here today, and like Eve, you're doing the right things. You're living for Jesus in the best way that you know how. You're working in your job or your career. You're doing the little things and the unseen things. And you might be thinking that nobody is really noticing what I'm doing, or the sacrifice that I am making, or that I'm doing the right things. But Jesus, I want you to know, Jesus has a message for you today. Perhaps you're doing the best in your job that you know how to do. You're doing the best in your business. You're living through these challenging times, and you're doing the best that you can. You may be a single parent. You're doing the best to stay positive, to be strong, and to raise your kids the best you can. You're trying to be strong for your family, but perhaps inside you're dying. You're helping your kids with online school, even though you're not an educator. You're doing your best to keep their education on track. Perhaps you had to make sacrifices during these difficult times, and you wonder, does anybody see? You might be thinking, does God even notice? Does he see? Does he know? Does he see? Does he understand? Know this, Jesus sees you, because he is Adonai El Rohi, my God, who sees me. You might even need to say this to yourself out loud right now. In fact, I want you to repeat after me these words. He is Adonai El Rohi, my God who sees me. In Luke chapter 4, verse 38, we read this, that after leaving the synagogue that day, Jesus went to Simon's home, where he found Simon's mother-in-law very sick with a high fever. "Please heal her," everyone begged. Standing at her bedside, he rebuked the fever, and it left her. And how do most great mothers throughout history show gratitude? The scripture continues, "And she got up at once and prepared a meal for them." Jesus called Simon, a business owner, to follow him. And Jesus saw the difficult situation that Simon and his family faced while caring for their sick mother. And Jesus stepped in to help them to fulfill what God was calling them to do. Jesus helped so that they could walk in obedience to what God had called them to. And then the video transitions again to the woman at the well. But this time she is in the marketplace. I want you to watch this clip with us.
Oranges.
Two shekels.
Thank you.
Plums.
Beautiful silver from Phoenicia. Do you want some?
Yeah.
You. We don't serve your kind here.
And what kind is that?
You know what you are.
Well, lucky for you, I can serve myself. You know, to stop me, you'd have to look at me.
Did you notice that nobody looked at her? Not even the person she wanted to buy from will even look at her. Society is ignoring her. Her husband doesn't love her. She is unseen and rejected by everyone around her. And then Jesus walks into her life and everything has changed. The scriptures tell us that Jesus and the disciples traveled from Judea to Galilee. And Jesus takes this shortcut through a place called Samaria. And this is significant because in doing so, Jesus would challenge the prejudices of his day. Around noon, they stop at a well, Jacob's well, just outside of a village called Sychar. The disciples leave Jesus alone at the well while they go to buy food. And Jesus is thirsty, but he doesn't have anything to draw water from the deep well with. He doesn't have a rope. He doesn't have a bucket. And this is where John chapter 4, verse 7 brings us. The scripture says this. Soon a Samaritan woman came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, "Please give me a drink." He was alone at the time because his disciples had gone into the village to buy some food. The woman was surprised, for Jews refused to have anything to do with Samaritans. She said to Jesus, "You are a Jew. I am a Samaritan woman. Why are you asking me for a drink?" Jesus replied, "If you only knew the gift God has for you and who you are speaking to, you would ask me, and I would give you living water." "But sir, you don't have a rope or a bucket," she said. "And this well is very deep. Where would you get this living water? And besides, do you think you're greater than our ancestor Jacob, who gave us this well? How can you offer better water than he and his sons and his animals enjoyed?" Jesus replied, "Anyone who drinks this water will soon become thirsty again. But those who drink the water I give will never be thirsty again. It becomes a fresh, bubbling spring within them, giving them eternal life." "Please, sir," the woman said, "give me this water. Then I'll never be thirsty again, and I won't have to come here to get water." "Go get your husband," Jesus told her. I don't have a husband," the woman replied. Jesus said, "You're right. You don't have a husband, for you have had five husbands, and you aren't even married to the man you're living with now. You certainly spoke the truth." "Sir," the woman said, "you must be a prophet." I think this woman represents the story of human brokenness today. A brokenness that separates us from God and from each other. And like this woman, there is nothing that humanity can do to fix its own brokenness. The only hope that humanity has is that God sees us. That he sent his son Jesus to step into our broken world and to bring healing. Jesus in this story is crossing four important barriers in order to heal this broken woman. The first is that racial barrier. The Jews and Samaritans, they don't get along and they don't like each other. There was this strong racial prejudice even in Jesus' day. And for millennia, the reason for racial tension and prejudice is because we offend and then we cannot forgive. This still separates people and races in this modern day. During the Babylonian exile, many of the Jews were exported to Babylon for 70 years. And some of the Jews stayed behind in Israel, and they intermarried with the local Canaanites living in the area. And this produced what the Jews considered a tribe of half-breeds that they called Samaritans. The Samaritans mixed both Jewish and Canaanite religious practices. And this ethnic and religious mixing totally offended the Jews. The Jews considered Samaritans racially inferior and religious heretics as a result. So this woman at the well was a racial and a religious outsider. And she represents for us today the lostness of humanity. But Jesus crossed the racial and religious barrier to see the lost. Another barrier that Jesus crossed was the cultural barrier between men and women. Jesus was talking to a strange woman in a public setting. And according to the social norms of the day, this was not acceptable and not polite. But Jesus crossed the cultural barrier between men and women to see the lost. Another barrier that Jesus crossed was that this woman was immoral. As a result, she was rejected by society. For example, women drew water in the morning during the cool of the day. That was their tradition. And they would go in groups to get water. And the village well was often kind of like the warung in Surabaya or the coffee shop of the day. It was the place where women went to chit-chat, ngobrol with their friends and talk about, you know, life in the village. But in this scene, we see this woman, and in the scripture, she is there in the heat of the day. She doesn't go with the other village women. She's alone. Why? Because she was a woman of scandalous reputation, a moral outcast. She had multiple husbands, and the man she was living with was not even her husband. Now, Jesus didn't condone her behavior or her sin. But Jesus loved her, and Jesus saw her, and he crossed that moral barrier in order to heal her. Jesus crossed racial barriers and religious barriers and cultural barriers and even moral barriers to speak to this woman and bring healing into her life. Jesus was a religious, Jewish, moral man who should have nothing to do with her. But Jesus is Adonai El Rohi, the God who sees. My God who sees me. And Jesus saw this woman. If God is going to use us, ICA, to reach broken people, if our church is going to grow, if we are going to be like Jesus in our action and not just in our name, it will require us to reach across some uncomfortable barriers. The next time Jesus puts you with people that make you uncomfortable, remember this story and its lessons, that Jesus saw the lost. Jesus went to the lost, and Jesus healed the lost. I want to watch this final scene together before we close. Check this out.
We ate the last Salome's bread last night. Esther, we need to go into town for food.
We can use the gold left for us at the fountain.
Very well.
There's a town about a mile west, Sikar.
You all go. I'll wait here.
Someone should stay with you, in case.
I'm all right. Meet me at that well when you come back. to give me a drink? Did you hear me?
That bad, huh?
What?
You, a Jew, ask for a drink from me, a Samaritan, and a woman.
I'm sorry. I should have said please.
You know, it's not safe for you to be alone out here.
Nor you. Why haven't you come with others? Why so late in the day? Don't women come to the wells in the cool of the morning?
Yeah, well, none of them will be seen with me, so I have to come out now, in the heat, as you have so kindly reminded me.
Why won't they be seen with you?
Long story.
I'd still like a drink of water, if you can spare it.
Amazing what a parched throat will do. Aren't I unclean to you? Won't you be defiled by this vessel?
Maybe some of my people say that about your women, but I don't.
Yeah? And what do you say?
I say if you knew who I am, you'd be asking me for a drink.
Really?
And I would give you living water.
Would. Except that you have nothing to draw water with, and this is a deep well. Besides, what do you need from me if you have your own supply of living water?
Long story.
But Jewish water is better than Samaritan water, hmm?
That's not what I said.
Are you a better man than our ancestor Jacob, who dug this well? Your water is better than his?
I know Jacob. And everyone who drinks this water will thirst again. But whoever drinks the water that I give him will never be thirsty again.
Wouldn't that be nice?
The water I give will become in a person a spring of water welling up to eternal life.
Really?
Yes, really.
Prove it.
First, go and call your husband and come back. I will show you both.
I don't have a husband.
You are right. You've had 5 husbands. And the man you're living with now is not your husband.
Oh, I see. You're a prophet. You're here to preach at me.
No.
Usually the one good thing about coming here alone is I can escape being condemned.
I'm not here to condemn you.
I've made mistakes. Too many. But it's men like you who have made it impossible for me to do anything about it.
How?
Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain. But you Jews insist Jerusalem is the only place for true worship.
They say that because the temple is there.
Yeah, exactly where we're not allowed.
I'm here to break those barriers. And the time is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father.
So, where am I supposed to go when I need God? I've never received anything from God, but I couldn't thank him even if I did.
Anywhere. God is spirit, and the time is coming and is now here that it won't matter where you worship, but only that you do it in spirit and truth. Heart and mind, that is the kind of worshiper he's looking for. It won't matter where you're from or what you've done. Do you believe what I'm telling you?
Until the Messiah comes and explains everything and sorts this mess out, including me, I don't trust in anyone.
You're wrong when you say that you've never received anything from God. This Messiah you speak of, I am he. The first one was named Ramin. You were a woman of purity who was excited to be married. But he wasn't a good man. He hurt you. And it made you question marriage and even the practice of your faith.
Stop it.
The second was Farzad. On your wedding night, his skin smelled like oranges.
To this day, every time you pass by the oranges in the market, you feel guilty for leaving him, because he was the only truly godly man you've been with. But you felt unworthy.
Why are you doing this?
I have not revealed myself to the public as the Messiah. You are the first. It would be good if you believed me.
You picked the wrong person.
I came to Samaria just to meet you. Do you think it's an accident that I'm here in the middle of the day?
I am rejected by others.
I know, but not by the Messiah.
And you know these things because you are the Christ. I'm going to tell everyone.
I was counting on it.
Spirit and truth.
Spirit and truth.
It won't be all about mountains or temples.
Soon, just the heart.
You promise?
I promise.
This man told me everything I've done. Oh, he must be the Christ!
Hey, wait!
Your water!
You forgot your
Fancy, a man who told me everything I ever did!
Rabbi, we got food. What would you like?
Ah, I have food to eat that you do not know about.
Who got you food?
Wait a minute. You told her? Mm-hmm. And she can tell others?
What food?
My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to accomplish his work.
You told her where you are?
Mm-hmm.
So does that mean?
It means we're going to stay here a couple of days. It's been a long time of sowing, but the fields are ripe for harvest.
And so it's time.
Let's go.
Yes!
Throw me like a stone in the water. Watch the mud rise up. Dress me like a lamb for the slaughter. Pour me in your cup. Should've known we'd bring trouble. Trouble gonna find you here.
At the end of the scene, the woman at the well says to Jesus that one day the Messiah will come. The one promised by God in the scriptures would come and explain everything to us. The one would come to show humanity how to live right. The one promised, the Messiah, would come to heal the brokenness in people. And Jesus responded to her and he said this, I am he. Today as we close, perhaps you're like Simon's wife. You're faithfully doing the right things, but you need help with your circumstances. Jesus helped Simon's wife. And today we're going to pray that Jesus will help you. Perhaps you feel like the woman at the well. You feel like God doesn't see you. This morning, we looked at a woman who was doing it right. We also saw a woman who was doing everything wrong. You know what both of these women had in common? Jesus saw both of them. He is Adonai El Rohi, my God who sees me. You know what else these women had in common? God loved both of them. The woman at the well was looking for solutions for her life. And Jesus answered, "I am He." Perhaps today you have the same questions. You're struggling with problems and brokenness, and you need a solution. I want you to know this morning, Jesus is saying to you, "I am He." He is the solution that you're looking for. Let's pray together. Lord, I just want to pray for your people this morning. Lord, I want to pray, first of all, for those that are doing the things right. They are doing the best that they can. They're living for you the best way that they know how. But they need your help. In their circumstances, they need your help. Jesus, I'm praying that just like you did for Simon and for his wife and his mother-in-law, would you step into their circumstances and would you help them? God, would you help them in their jobs? Would you help them in their marriages? God, would you help them as they're raising their children? Lord, would you provide the money that they need to pay their bills? God, would you give them the direction that they're looking for their future? Lord, I pray that you would heal physical bodies. God, we ask, would you help us? Adonai El Rohi, my God who sees me, would you help us? Lord, I also want to pray for those who feel rejected by others for one reason or another. They don't quite fit, and perhaps they're watching this program on their screen right now. Lord, I pray that you would help them. You are the God who doesn't reject. You are the God who sees me. And Lord, I pray that they would realize and know that God, you see them, that you love them, and that God, you will accept them, Lord. God, I also want to pray for those who are here today and they have to admit they haven't done things right. And as a result, perhaps they believe that, well, because I've done so much junk in my life, God, you can never see me, you can never love me, and you could never receive me. Lord, I pray for that person that they would know that, God, whether they're rejected by others or because of their sin, Lord, you are still Adonai El Rohi, my God who sees me. Lord, would you bring healing to those broken by their own mistakes? Would you bring acceptance to those who feel rejected today? We ask these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. The story of the woman at the well continues in John chapter 4. And she becomes a follower of Jesus. And then she goes and brings her whole village to meet the Messiah. If you would like to make that choice, the same choice that the woman at the well made to follow Jesus, here's what you can do. First, believe that Jesus is the Son of God. Ask Jesus forgiveness for the things that you've done wrong. Make a choice to follow Jesus and follow his teachings found in the Bible. Tell somebody the decision that you've made. And finally, go to ICA's website, click on the button, "Yes, I believe," fill out that online form, and somebody from ICA will contact you and talk to you about what to do next. I just want to encourage you to join us next week as we begin this new preaching series entitled League of Kings. God bless you. We will see you online next week.
See the light breaking through all the lies with the truth. Hear the sound of the wind. Let the roar of heaven begin. Can't stay silent, can't stay still. When you show up in power, glory revealed. Oh, I can't stay.
Depression must end all the shame.